Hi folks, welcome back again this week. Let me read a little bit of scripture and let's pay close attention to what it actually says. Biggest mistake people make when reading the Bible is they don't consider what it says. They're more interested in reading the words than they are in understanding what the words are telling them. We're in 1 Timothy chapter 6. We're starting at verse 2. These are the things you are to teach and urge on them, on people. If anyone teaches false doctrines and does not agree with the sound instruction of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to godly teaching, such a person is conceited and understands nothing. Now that's important. That is important. Anyone teaches false doctrines. Well, we know that God, Father God, is truth. And we know that the spirit of Father Truth is unconditional love. And we know that love starts with loving the truth. So if anyone teaches false doctrines, then who are they worshiping? Who are they serving? Well, as God is truth, the devil is falsehood. A falsehood does not love truth, because falsehood is always creating false doctrines. Beware those whose doctrines do not agree to the sound instruction of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, Jesus tells us plainly in Scripture that he is God in flesh. He's the everlasting Father, Father Truth. And where does it say somewhere? Wise salvation. We don't have another one. All right, we can mark down where we are here. 1 Timothy 6 and 3. Wise, I-S-E, salvation, A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. 2 Timothy 3:15. Start at 14. As for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, that's the Bible, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Now, somewhere it's in Revelation, it says, Jesus is the Word. The Word is truth. Jesus is Father Truth. Correct. Where do we find the truth? In the Word. So we head back to 1 Timothy?
1 Timothy 6:3.
And what do we find? If anyone teaches false doctrines and does not agree to the sound instruction of our Lord Jesus Christ, sound instruction comes from the Word, the Bible. It hasn't survived millennia, countless millennia, for no good reason. And our Jewish brothers and sisters have taken good care. The Orthodox have taken good care to preserve the Word. I remember as a young man, before the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, or at least the release publicly of the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls and the translations, a lot of people said that the Bible was just something manufactured by modern man. Then they found the Dead Sea Scrolls and got them interpreted and made it public that what it says in the Bible today in the 20th, now the 21st centuries, was thousands of years ago the same Bible. It hasn't survived for no good reason. I remember when people said, oh, the whole idea of Pontius Pilate is all bullshit. Well, there was no evidence of a leader named Pontius Pilate. And then they uncovered a milestone marker over in Italy that had Pontius Pilate's name as the governor who installed that milestone. All of a sudden, Pontius Pilate, there was evidence that such a man existed. So, if people, what they teach doesn't agree with sound doctrine in the Bible, beware, beware. Somebody's bullshitting you. And to godly teaching, what is godly teaching? Well, if God is truth, and the spirit of truth is unconditional love, then godly teaching would be teaching that supports truth. Jesus is his name, and supports unconditional love. So when you find people who want to make excuse not to follow godly teaching, teaching that, what does it mean to put forward something that
promotes
teaching that promotes love, and even your enemies, that starts to get a little closer to unconditional love, doesn't it? Jesus said, love your enemies, don't hate them. He said, go the extra mile. Godly teaching. The people who reject such things are conceited and understand nothing. Now, take point of that. They don't understand everything they should. That isn't what it said, is it? It said they understand nothing. And that's true. That's true. They understand nothing. I don't care how smart they think they are. I don't care how many years they spent in seminary. I don't care if they're a professor or a rabbi or a priest or a pastor. I don't care what they are. If they disagree with the sound doctrine of following what the Bible tells us and of godly teaching, they know nothing. Because the God we serve is truth in an attitude of love. Jesus is his name. We serve nothing else. So,
and if they, important reminder, if they know nothing, then it's not safe to take instruction from them on anything.
That's right.
So just because you might think, oh, well, maybe I won't listen to their teaching on the Bible, but maybe they could teach me something about living my life. Better to just stay away from it.
Run.
Yeah.
Run from such people.
Run.
Such a man has an unhealthy interest in controversies and quarrels about words that result in envy, strife, malicious talk, evil suspicions, and constant friction between men of corrupt mind who have been robbed of the truth and who think that godliness is a means to financial gain. Well, if I act like this or I act like that, I'm a godly man and everybody rushes to me and you know, wants to give me the front row seat and everything, and then I'm going to get wealthy. Really? There's something wrong. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Can we, contentment?
Being at rest in what God has done.
Yeah.
In your life and...
whatever condition you're in, be content with what you have. Do you wake up in the morning alive? Thank God. Do you have something to put in your mouth to eat? Thank God. Do you have some place to escape danger? Even if it's under a bridge? Thank God.
And even if you happen to find yourself with none of those things, do you not still have the hope that Jesus died for you and that when you die, there's something better
waiting for you
on the other side? We have hope. If not, in the absence of everything else, in Jesus, we still have hope.
Thank God. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. That's not much, is it? Just food and clothing. Isn't it amazing that you can go down to the local Salvation Army and they'll feed you? Isn't it amazing that you can go down to the thrift store, the Salvation Army's thrift shop or whatever, and get free clothes? Thank God. People who want to get rich or get more over and above that, food and clothing, fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love, and it uses in the NIV here that I'm using, 84 edition, the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Is that correct? Yeah, but it lacks something. When Jesus said that you cannot serve two masters, you cannot serve God and money, he didn't really use the word money, he used the word mammon. And mammon in scripture is anything that you value more than God. So it's not just money. It's anything you value more than God. It says somewhere, unless a man hates his mother, his brother, his sisters, his father, if you love them more than you love God, you don't belong to God. Boy, that seems pretty strong, doesn't it? But think about it. Think about it. Do I love my Wendy more than I love God? No. Absolutely not. God is first and foremost in my life. God is first and foremost in Wendy's life. God is truth in an attitude of love. His name is Jesus. And if Jesus lives in my Wendy, she'll love me. And if Jesus lives in me, I'll love my Wendy. I won't do anything to harm her or disgrace her. I have no contempt for her because Jesus dwells in me. There's lots of friggin' atheists out there who say, I love, they're liars. They don't love anywhere close to how much, when God is in you, how much you love. Because when God is in you, you will love even your enemies. You will even love those who spitefully use you and persecute you and speak poorly of you. You will even care about them. The love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. The love of mammon is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for mammon, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Flee from all of this and pursue righteousness, truth in an attitude of love. Pursue godliness, pursue faith, pursue love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith, obedience to the God you claim to serve. Is faith. Faith is an action. It's not just what you believe. It's putting into practice what you believe. So, if you turn the other cheek, you're operating in faith. If you care about the guy who just slandered you, you're operating in faith. If you forgive, even when the people don't deserve forgiveness, you're operating in faith. Now remember this. It says in Scripture, when you are asked to forgive, forgive. As God has forgiven you. When you are asked. So, lots of people say that, well, if someone mistreats you, you should just turn the other cheek and walk away. But does that help the person? Remember, it's truth and love in you. Does that help the person who has done you a wrong? Does that help them just turning around, walking away? No. No, they think they're on top. They think they've done nothing wrong. They think they're the boss. God's the boss. They're not the boss. So when I turn the other cheek, I make sure I make mention that the reason I'm turning the other cheek is because the God I serve is truth in an attitude of love, and I refuse to serve your God. Because from the way you're treating me, your God is the devil, and I refuse to walk your path. So I'm turning the other cheek. Will that help the person? Well, if that person is a wayward sheep, it very well may show that sheep that, oh, maybe I did wrong in slandering Ed. Will that perhaps help him to correct his behavior? Would that not maybe prompt him to want to know the God I serve a little better? Does it really say that in the Bible, Ed? I don't think so, eh? Doesn't that open the door to say, well, I can show you in the Bible if you'd like. And if that is a sheep, he'll listen. He'll say, yeah, show me where it says that. Turn the other cheek. I don't think so, Ed. Easy to look it up and show them. This confrontation has opened a whole dialogue now. This is a sheep. He'll listen. It says that in the scripture too, right here, or up here. That if they belong to God, they will listen to us. If they don't, they won't. So if the person who's being mean to you is a goat, does your saying bringing to light why you're turning the other cheek, does that do that goat some good? Doesn't it bring conviction? Doesn't it show that goat that Your act of turning the other cheek is more righteous than his act of kicking your ass? You see what I mean? God has a wonderful way of working on the conscience of men. Beware, though, the devil works on the conscience as well. But God uses the conscience. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. What's the good confession? Well, it's Romans 10, 9 and 10. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is God. Remember that. In the sight of God, who gives life to everything. Does truth not give life to everything? And of Christ Jesus, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate made the good confession. What? How did Jesus make the what good confession before Pilate? I don't remember reading that.
Who do you say I am?
And Pilate answered, well, they're telling me you're the Christ. What did he say? It's as you say. Yeah. I'm the Christ. You see the good confession? I charge you to keep this command without spot, without blame, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler. God, the King of kings and Lord of lords. Now, I'm at 1 Timothy 6:15. It's defining God. Remember that. You're going to be an eye opener in a minute. I'll read it again for you. I charge you to keep this command without spot, without blame, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler. God's the chief enchilada, you know what I mean? He's the big deal. God, the King of kings and Lord of lords. Now we're going to go to Revelation 17, 14. 17, 14. They will make war against the Lamb. But who's the Lamb? Jesus said he's the Lamb of God. They will make war against the Lamb. But the Lamb will overcome them because he, the Lamb, is the King of kings and Lord of lords. And with him will be his called, chosen, and faithful followers. The Lamb is, back to 1 Timothy 6?
15.
15? God. Now, I don't know how you read it, but it doesn't get much plainer to me. Jesus is Lord. He's not a man. He's not something created. Now, he took on the form of man. In other words, he took on upon himself mortality. He took on the form of man. It's here on the screen. So he who is immortal, the Lord of lords and King of kings, the ruler of all rulers, Father Truth, took off his immortality and put on mortality. He put on the form of man. Mortality. Entered the womb of the Virgin, and as all things that are mortal have to be birthed, and then they have to grow into adulthood or maturity, so God did exactly the same in this mortal form. And then he presented himself to his people. Let's go to Philippians 2:6. Speaking of the Christ, of Jesus, who being in very nature God himself, but did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he, Jesus, humbled himself and became obedient to death. Everything that's mortal must die. Everything. Even death on a cross. Therefore, God, Father Truth, exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. That does not say that at the name of Yahweh or at the name of Lord or at the name of God, or at the name of Prince, or at the name of King of Kings, or at the name of Yeshua, or Allah. No. At the name of Jesus, do men support what the Bible says? If they don't, what do they know?
Nothing.
Nothing. They may think they understand everything, but according to what the Bible says, they know nothing.
To go along with this verse elsewhere where Jesus says, Father, protect them. By your name, the name you gave me.
Yep. It's on the screen. Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me. They gave him, the angel came to Joseph in a dream and told him, you are to give him the name Jesus. That's, consider it. What did Philip say?
Yeah. Lord, show us the Father, and that'll be enough for us. And Philip said, don't you know me, Philip? Jesus said, don't you know me, Philip, after I've been with you so long? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father.
Yeah. Jesus is Lord, folks. Yeah. Love is what he wants of us. People say, well, I try to love, but I'm going to go out on a limb here, and I am going to tell you something. We are going to go back to Isaiah.
Turn it on.
44. We'll start at 6. 8. We're going to go 6 to 8. 8 is the important one. This is what the Lord says, Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord God Almighty. I am the first and I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God. He's it. Who then is like me? Let him proclaim it. What, that he's like God? No. Know your grammar a little better than that. Do I have to say to read it again? Okay. I am the first and I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God. Who then is like me? Let him proclaim that there is no God besides Jesus. That's the subject of this phrase, this paragraph, if you will. This is what we're talking about, the identity of the first and the last as the Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord God Almighty. If we're anything like God, we're going to agree with that. We're going to substantiate, yes, Jesus is Lord. There is no other God. Let him declare and lay out before me what has happened since I established my ancient people and what is yet to come. Yes, let him foretell. I don't prophesy in public, but you can ask Wendy if Dad tells her what's coming. I think she'll. Do not tremble. This is verse 8. Do not tremble. Do not be afraid. Did I not proclaim this long ago? Excuse me. Did I not proclaim and foretell this long ago? You are my witnesses. You want to know your station in life, your appointment from God? You are God's witnesses. Is there any God besides Jesus? No, there is no other rock. I know not one. So what's our appointment? What's our job? Why are we here? Well, according to this, it says we're here to prove that Jesus is Lord. We're here to give evidence, to testify. Remember last week's video, we talked to the four horsemen to conquer. The bow of the mouth shoots the arrows to conquer falsehood, the devil. The sword of truth, which is the word of God. It's the evidence that substantiates our testimony. Remember that? Go back and look at watch last week's video. You'll learn something more. Let's go to Revelation. Where is it? 7. Oh boy, Revelation. I do remember it. 1:17. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and he said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and I am the last." Well, wait a minute. We just read in Isaiah that God Almighty is the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever, and I hold the keys to death and Hades. You want life? Jesus holds the keys. Remember that. Call upon the name of the Lord, and he'll save you. Deny him, and you're toast. The more evidence that we can give to support our testimony as good and faithful witnesses, you remember, it's a testimony just to turn the other cheek. It's a testimony to follow God, to love even your enemies. It's a testimony. What did he say? Come on, follow me. Be surprised. We all have a job to do. And that job starts with our confession, of which even Jesus before Pilate made that good confession. What did he say again?
Who do you say I am?
Yeah, I am the Christ. I come from a kingdom you have no idea. So Jesus is Lord. Love one another. And, Lord willing, I hope to see you again next week. Bye for now. Love y'all.